Okay, so now that brings us to the important concept of depth of field. As I mentioned to you earlier, for any given image sensor or image plane location, there is one plane in the scene that is perfectly focused. All things, all objects that lie outside of that plane are going to be out of focus, and the degree of defocus is going to increase with its distance from the plane of focus. We know this. And this is in continuous domain when you're talking about your optical image. But we also know that images have finite resolution. They're made of pixels of finite size. So it turns out that the best focus region in the scene, or the depth of the range of depths in the scene that are best focused, are those points in the scene for which the blur circle lies within a single pixel. So as long as the blur circle happens to be smaller in diameter than the size of a pixel, all points are going to be equally out of focus or equally focused. And that's why you see here that there's a range of depths here that are equally in focus, and the same applies to points in the scene right here. And then points that are further away from that region, that depth of field, are going to get progressively out of focus. So the range of object distances for which the image is sufficiently well focused, that is the range over which the blur B is less than a pixel size, is called the depth of field of the imaging system. So let's find the depth of field of a lens system. So for that, we have to first define the pixel size. You have a finite pixel size here, so let's call that C. And now we want to see what is the range of distances of the object O for which the blur is going to be smaller than C. So let's consider this point, O1. This is the point for which the diameter of the blur circle exactly equals the size of the pixel, C. And in this case, because the point is in front or closer to the image, the lens itself, it is closer to the lens than O, for this point, the image is going to be formed behind the image plane with a blur circle of diameter C. And then there is another point, O2, which is further away from the lens, where the image is going to be formed in front of the image plane, but then it again diverges to create a blur circle of size C. And O2 minus O1 is the depth of field of the imaging system. And we can find this out pretty easily because we have an expression for the blur circle diameter. So in that blur circle diameter expression, instead of B, we are going to just plug in C, which is the size of your pixel. And for this scenario here where the object is in front, you're going to have O minus O1, and you get one expression. For the case where the object is further away than the plane of focus, you're going to get O2 minus O1, and again, the diameter is set to C, which is the size of the pixel. So you get these two expressions. Now note that we know the focal length, we know the F number, we know C, which is the size of the pixel, and we know the distance of the plane of focus. And so now we can get a simple expression for the depth of field, which is O2 minus O1, by simply using these two expressions. Well, it's not a simple expression, but it's an expression that tells you what the depth of field is. Interesting thing to note here, that the distance between O2 and O is greater than the distance between O1 and O. That is, the closer and closer you get to the lens, the defocus is going to increase more rapidly. So this brings us to an interesting concept, which is called the hyperfocal distance. The hyperfocal distance is the closest distance that you would focus a lens at, for which all points beyond that distance are going to be in focus. So from that depth, O, onwards, all points beyond that, all the way to infinity, are going to produce a blur circle that is smaller than the size of a pixel. That's called the hyperfocal distance. So what that also means is that when we consider a point at infinity and the parallel rays of light that come from that point, so you're going to set O2 to infinity and you have parallel rays coming to the lens from that point, these rays are going to converge at a point and then they're going to diverge again. And when they do, the blur circle it creates on the image plane is going to be exactly equal to the size of a pixel. That's what we want to find, right? So the focus distance O for which that is true is the hyperfocal distance. And it turns out that we can easily compute this distance by plugging in O2 equal to infinity in our previous equation for depth of field. So we get h, the hyperfocal distance, is equal to f squared divided by n times c plus f. F again is the focal length, n is the f number, and c is the size of the pixel. The hyperfocal distance is an important concept. If you create an imaging system which is focused on the hyperfocal distance, then you know that all points beyond that are going to be in focus. It's only points that are closer, as you get closer and closer to the lens, that things are going to go out of focus. It's a very useful concept because in the case of a smartphone camera, you want to set the focus at the hyperfocal distance so that when you take pictures, you know that there is a certain distance beyond which your images are always going to be well focused. Okay, so now let's take a look at this trade-off between depth of field and the brightness of the image. Remember, we're using a lens rather than a pinhole camera because it creates brighter images. So let's take a look at what price we pay in terms of depth of field by doing so. So here is a situation where you have three paintings. You have one at 1 meter, the other one, the second one is at 1.5 meters, and the third one at 2 meters. And we've used a lens with a focal length of 50 millimeters. It's focused on the painting at 1 meter. And it has an aperture diameter of 25 millimeters or an F number of 2. So it's wide open, right? That's what you see right here in the corner. And you see that the painting at 1 meter is perfectly focused. It's a bright enough image. But the one at 1.5 is out of focus, and the one at 2 is even more out of focus. So let's now stop down the aperture. Let's increase the F number or reduce the diameter of the aperture. When you do that, you find that the paintings that are out of focus are getting more in focus, but obviously the image is getting darker because less light is being collected by the lens. If you go further down to an F number of 8, you get a much darker image, but a sharper image. If you go further, you're almost approaching a pinhole now, and with an F number of 16, you get an image that's pretty much focused everywhere, except that it's really dark. So we can summarize this trade-off by saying that a large aperture, which means a small F number, implies a bright image. Or what that really means in a real-world application is a shorter exposure time. So if you're capturing video, you can capture higher frame rate in the video, much faster succession of images. So brighter image or shorter exposure time. And the price that you pay is that you have a shallow depth of field. On the other hand, if you use a small aperture, which means a large F number, you get a darker image, which means that you need to expose the image for a longer time, and you have a much larger depth of field. So now I want to demonstrate an important property of a lens. For that, I've put together a little tissue box camera, this one right here. So this is a tissue box, and in the front, I've cut out a circle, and I've attached a lens there. This lens, by the way, is 5 diopters in power. 5 diopters in terms of focal length implies 1/5 meters, which is 1/5 meters is roughly 200 millimeters. That's the focal length of this lens. And in the back here, where you have the tissue box opening, I've attached a tracing paper. which is translucent, to form the image. So if you point this camera in some direction, you see that you get a nice clean image, a large image that looks like that. Nothing wrong with it, it's bright, it's in focus. But here's the interesting thing. If I now take this large lens of this camera and I block it in some way, let's say I cover half of the lens, or I paint something on top of it, or make a pattern and stick on top of it, what do you think might happen? Just think about this for a second. Well, let's do this experiment. This is the same camera with a part of the lens blocked out. What I've attached to the lens here is some insulation tape in the shape as a cross. And you should take a moment to try and guess what the image might look like. Well, it turns out that the image looks pretty much the same. It is indeed in focus, but it's a bit darker. And that makes sense. It's darker because there's less light being passed through by the lens. But it's sort of a non-intuitive thing, and perhaps it's intuitive to you, that the image continues to be in focus. So for the focus plane, the plane of focus, it doesn't matter what the shape of the aperture is, you're going to still get whatever part of the lens is exposed to the light, it's going to focus those rays to create a sharp image. And this is a really important feature of a lens, because in a real world setting, if you have a little bit of dust on the lens, or if you have little droplets on the lens, it doesn't really matter. The light, as long as light is able to go through, there's enough of the lens that's open to the scene, you tend to get images that look pretty good. And that makes lenses really useful. Now, I want to end with another interesting property of a lens. So let's take the scenario where you have an image plane on the left, right here, but you have a tilted lens in this case, right here. So let's first consider the optical axis that runs through the center of this lens and pierces the image plane right here. So if you consider this point and you want to see which point in the scene is going to be focused, you can use the Gaussian lens law to figure that out. There is indeed a point, P, that's going to be perfectly focused at this point. But because the image plane is tilted, we can guess that the plane of focus is not going to be parallel to the image plane in this particular case. So what is it going to be? So to construct this, there's a very simple construction here. You extend the image plane, and you extend a line that goes through the lens. These two lines, shown here as dotted lines, intersect at the point Q. And now you're going to connect this point Q with the point P. And that is the plane of focus of this tilt lens camera. And so now the question you may be asking is, what is the utility of this system? Well, there are applications where you want to have a camera looking out at something, but what you're interested in maintaining in focus is not a plane that is parallel to the image plane, but it's a different plane. For instance, a ground plane. So imagine that you're out in the street and you want to take a picture of something in front of you, but you want to see the entire ground plane, the road, and all the people on the road are in focus, but you're not interested in what happens to the sky and things that are further up. So in this case, you can tilt the lens and you can ensure that the entire ground plane is in focus in the image. And so this construction that I just showed you is called the Scheimpflug condition. And there are indeed tilt cameras that one can go out and buy. Photographers often use the tilt camera to capture some really interesting images with depths of field that are very different from what a normal camera would give you.